next speaker of the International Conference Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue in a Pluralistic World, Philosophical and Theological Perspectives, is Professor John Farina from George Mason University, United States of America. He's a friend of Constanța, of His Grace Archbishop Theodosie of Tomis. His Grace is present, he's here with us. He's a friend of our Faculty of Theology. It's an honor for us to have you together with us, dear Professor. Please.
Thank you, Ayawan. Greetings, Archbishop, and all of my dear friends in Constanța. I'm sorry I can't be with you. I was injured and won't be able to go to Europe this year, in all likelihood. So I'm glad I can be with you for a short time via this technology. I'm talking to you from Washington, D.C., in the Watergate complex, which many of you might remember from the 1970s was the home of a famous political scandal that brought down the presidency of Richard Nixon. I want to talk today about religion and politics, but not in terms of contemporary affairs, at least not in terms of practical contemporary affairs, but more about the philosophy and the theology behind religion and society, this role that religion plays in our societies, the relationship between church and state. And I want to start off by recalling the myth that comes from a French village in Provence, Tarascon. And it is the myth of Tarascon, who was a horrible beast that had many appeared to be like a giant turtle or dinosaur and terrorized the people of the village for many years. Until a young saintly girl tamed the beast with her innocence and her holiness, her true religion, and brought the beast into the city square. And the people, seeing this terrible monster, reacted immediately and killed, and it didn't fight back for once. All their efforts before to kill it were useless, but now they succeeded. And as the beast died, they realized they had made a terrible mistake because the beast had become their friend. And they erected a great statue to the beast, which is still in the village, and they renamed their village after the beast. It's now Tarascon. I think that's an apt metaphor or figure for the role of religion in society. And now I want to turn to a text that many of you may have. I don't know if you do. If you do, I delivered it to Ayawan, but if it's there, I'll be reading from the text from page 7, the bottom, and on, the political and the theological. As you all know, it was not really in Europe until the Edict of Nantes in 1598, that new models for the role of religion in the state emerged. As the French historian Blandine Criagel points out, that document, the edict, represented an effort by European governments to craft a new secular basis for society in which citizenship wouldn't be defined by religious affiliation, and in which the confessional state would be a thing of the past. The goal was to create a public square in which all might participate as citizens, not as religious persons separated by their faith confessions, but as citizens united in the common public space of the modern nation. Along with this political movement grew up an intellectual tradition in political science that tended to read Thomas Hobbes as a warrant for this new kind of society. Rather than see him as an apologist, willing or not, for state supremacy over the churches and a totalitarian control of civil society, which one could very easily get from Hobbes. Instead, these people praised Hobbes as an advocate of personal freedom, because in areas in which the sovereign does not speak, the person is free to do whatever he or she wishes. Yet this vision has never been completely fulfilled. The secular state, ironically, remains reliant upon creating a religion-like identity for the state. It is not the state's impotence against revanchist religious sentiment of the bourgeoisie that causes this, but rather its success at relegating religion to the personal, private, therapeutic dimensions. The post-Hobbesian political world is not one in which individual religious freedoms are maximized because the sovereign limits itself to a certain external and structural elements, as many current political theorists who consider themselves followers of Hobbes would hope. Rather, the secular state searches desperately for some grounding, some point of linkage to more than the world of positivism, some kind of transcendence which, ironically, it cannot admit to. Religion begins, in fact, with a personal experience of what Rudolf Otto simply called the numinous, that primitive experience of awe and reverence in the presence of the totally other, is not primarily an experience of dread or fear. Paradoxically, it's an attraction to the unknown, a familiarity of the other that draws the individual into a relationship in which she feels herself suddenly in communion. She's part of some larger scheme. She transcends her isolation and experiences the social in its most basic form. The experience is at once personal and public because it's relational and multivalent. Secondary efforts to represent that experience are part of the construction of a religious system, ritual, symbol, and the development of a language of theology all follow. With the process comes a transformation. The experience takes on a less unique form. It moves from epiphany to elocution. The epiphany is an experience ringed off by mystic fire. The elocution is vulgar in common language. The experience is sacred. The theological expression is not. In this way, it can be said that all theology has a built-in secularity. Theologies, because they are sacred, secular expressions, because they are social, secular expressions, can be matched to political forms. Mystical experiences cannot. The secular state can easily endorse the theological enterprise, but always remains wary of the mystic. Mystic may also be the prophet, if he speaks forth in a sufficiently primitive language that differentiates itself from the secular theology of the church or of the state. Massimo Cacchiaro asks, what is the political form that matches a political theology? In traditional religious societies, there's a harmony between the form and the political theological language. For instance, in the Puritan societies of American New England in the 17th century, an innerworldly asceticism, to borrow a term from Max Weber, was present. Those societies developed an economy of competition along with those innerworldly ascetics as they each tried to demonstrate their place in God's providential plan. A capitalistic economy grew out of this system and harmoniously related to it. Greed was tempered by Christian charity, complacence and sloth by the Christian virtue of fortitude. The state and the economic system it supported existed to aid the person in the attainment of his end, which was to glorify God. Now the secular state, by contrast, cannot make such claims. Its claims to supremacy are eschatological. It presents itself as part of a new age, a better age. It represents the end of history. The problem that arises from this is clear for Cacciato. He says, how can the state be founded on a new total organization as definitive and comprehensive system of economic contradictions and of confessional civil wars. If the state is itself aware of not being able to represent the whole, if it wants to be deduced merely rationally as a worldly power, how can the state pretend to be valued as ultimate if its own project is radically detached from the idea of a theologically founded sovereignty? Its form claims to be absolutely legitimized as an agent of the overall process of secularization that cannot, however, allow in principle absolute positions, end quote. Now, this predicament of the modern secular state assures that political discourse eventually will take on the language of a theology, twice removed from the primal religious experience with its multivalent qualities, twice secular. So the problem of what form a polity should take is in no way resolved by the secular state. The claims at constructing an earthly paradise with no relation to the heavens vanish in the daylight of the procedural republic that pathetically offers utilitarian explanations to the problem of how to ground the state. The Leviathan state, which has all power to define the political, represents nothing beyond itself. Any vague claims to the common good are lost in the contradictions of opposing data streams. Everyone looks to the state for validation of their contracts, of their currency, to be sure, but also of their values and ethics. People want an all-powerful state that stands for whatever they want it to. Yet, the state must make this validation representing only the thinnest conceptions of fairness and equal treatment. René Girard explains the formation of the modern judicial system, which is an example of this dynamic of the secularization of primitive experience. Many of you are familiar with his work, and I won't spend much time on it. But for him, the judicial system is the result of a process of secularization and rationalization of the dynamics of sacrifice. By vindicating the absolute monopoly of legitimate vengeance, the state completes the process begun by ritual sacrifice, rationalizing and developing greatly its effectiveness, rather than trying to stop vengeance, the legal system rationalizes it. It turns it into an extremely effective technique of healing and, secondly, of preventing violence. This is an effective secularization that benefits society and perpetuates the sacred wisdom. Religion is not hindered by such secularization, rather it's benefiting. It gives its life for the good of society. It sacrifices itself by secularizing sacrifice and saves itself while saving others. The great religions of the world all do this. The cult or new religious movement, by contrast, cannot do this. It's too interested in creating a unique identity, in setting itself off from the rest of the world. But that is not what makes it live long. Unless it can one day die, it will live only briefly. Like celibate shakers who could never shed their faith in a particular institution of celibacy, and because of that, set themselves off from the rest of society so well that there are only three of them left in the world today. Violence, theology, and law are linked in the process of secularization. Should law try to break that linkage, as it does in the case of legal positivism, which is ubiquitous in the West, it becomes arbitrary and capricious. Should theology try to break it, it becomes fundamentalistic, cut off from all warrants other than its own assertions. The mystical dimension of religion will try again and again to distance itself from theology. It refers back to the more primitive moment and rejects the limits placed on it by theology. Yet, it is only an aporia, lasting for a moment. It cannot live without secularization. If it tries to, it remains wholly mysterious, wholly of inarticulate, crude, silent. Efforts to banish religion from society, to control its expression, to make it an organ of the state, to temper it, all fail, because it is not based on a sacred, ineffable fire alone. Religion has tamed that fire, has translated itself using the same mechanisms society uses to convey meaning and pass on values. Religion can only be replaced with another religion. The gods of the Greeks and Romans can be conquered by Christ and all the saints, but mere mortals are powerless against them. Purely secular attempts to replace religion succeed only to the degree that they assume religious dimensions. So movements that mimic religion, like communism and socialism, succeed in part, but not completely, because they rely too much on the state and on suppression. They appear as inferior gods in the long run. Scientism, too, has some success because of its discipline and its dedicated encouragement. Atheism, by contrast, however, because it is only denied, never succeeds. It is unnatural, born of sickness, the product of delusion, betrayal, or ignorance. Like the mythical beast that I began beginning to speak of, Tarasque, religion, in its primitive form, is a terrifying force that threatens the human community. When, however, it is tamed through the process of secularization, that mature religion becomes a friend. Yet the foolish, frightened by the threat it poses to the village, often try to kill it. Those secularists think they are saving their state from a monster. When they have killed it, however, they realize their folly and seek to memorialize it and restore it to life. What they can create is only a distorted form of the living beast. On its part, the beast, once tamed, is willing to give its life for the good of society because it knows it will be reborn. Thank you.
So thank you very much, dear Professor John. Thank you very much. I open the session for questions. Yes, Professor Osman Bilen from Izmir, Turkey.
Hello, Professor. We met.
Yes,
Yash.
Yeah.
How are you?
Yeah, fine. Thank you. I wish you well soon.
Thank you.
If I didn't misunderstand that, as if you. By making that analogy, the religion in its primitive form is a kind of wild, but it must go through a process of secularization. You know, that is the meaning of taming. So is
right.
That necessary? I mean, that without taming, I mean, it should remain as wild. Is that your main point?
My reflections were really on the relationship between theology and secularization, and I think that this is a complicated relationship. But yes, part of what I was saying was as you have described.
Yeah. Okay. In that case, actually I agree to a certain degree that this process of secularization is something that all different religions should face this or that way, in different ways. But what is the possibility that I mean, the secularization will effect a change in a religion in the positive way or the negative way. What is the criteria to differentiate those two possibilities?
Well, I think what I was trying to do is speak against the extremes of secularization, of a purely secular state on the one hand, and of a fundamentalistic theology on the other hand. That, in fact, the way in which a mature religion involves a process of secularization, I mean, theology involves secularization, because we take this primitive mystical experience and we begin to express it in human forms. So in that sense, it is a process of moving into the the everyday, the age, the secular. And that is not a negative thing, that is a necessary thing. So a good theology does that well. A good theology retains the tension between the mystical and the secular expression, and always remembers that the expression is a secular expression, which is not perfect. If it thinks that the expression is perfect and is set in stone, it becomes a fundamentalism. Okay? And on the other hand, the state, if the state is so foolish to try to kill religion, it's left with a statue of this monster. It's left with an artificial creation by which it's trying to do something that it needs to live, which is create value and create meaning and create order.
Thank you.
Yes. If there are any other questions, His Grace Archbishop Feodosie, please.
În primul rând, îmi extind bucuria să vă întâlnesc pe calea aceasta, ai verificat pe YouTube. Aș vrea să fac o precizare. Ați vorbit de fundamentalismul religiei și, iată, în cazul ateismului, de extremism. Cele două nu se pot împăca într-o anumită situație. Când nu se pot împăca? Când cel ce este adeptul unei religii pozitive, care promovează dragostea și relația de pace și prietenie, vorbește din afara religiei. Trebuie să te afli întotdeauna în lăuntru ca să vorbești ca om religios. Există situații când oamenii se pretind religioși și atunci sunt pe una sau cealaltă extremă. Religia pozitivă, și mai ales noi vorbim de religia, religiile monoteiste, să spunem că sunt pozitive, care sunt prezente aici, religiile abrahamice. Sigur că au la bază iubirea, bunătatea, dar totdeauna cel religios trebuie să vorbească dinăuntru, să fie el însuși un om religios și atunci îi privește și pe ceilalți cu iubire. Religia nu poate să ducă la extremă dacă este situată în poziția aceasta. Omul religios are reper binele suprem, binele absolut și nu numai reper, ci se hrănește din binele absolut, din binele suprem. Dumneavoastră, de pildă, nu sunteți un teolog de formație, dar un teolog prin căutare. Dumneavoastră l-ați găsit pe Dumnezeu căutându-L. Această căutare trebuie să fie perpetuă. Nu l-am căutat și azi l-am găsit. Nu-mi mai pasă de acum, sunt cu Dumnezeu. Căutarea trebuie să fie continuă, raportarea să fie mereu fidelă față de modelul pe care îl ai. Dacă acceptați ceea ce v-am sugerat.
Yes, our translator will try to translate, to summarize the comments from His Grace Archbishop Theodosie.
I'm trying to summarize this. In a nutshell, it was a question regarding a parallel that can be drawn between extremism and secularization. And a final remark made by His Grace that once you have found God, you, for instance, are a person who have found God because you have been seeking for Him. This has to be a perpetual search. You can't say, I have found God and now I am with Him forever. It's a perpetual search, and this relation has always to be kept alive. So the question regarded what you could comment on the parallel between extremism and secularization.
I didn't get the question. I didn't get your last sentence. Please repeat it.
So if you could expand on what you see, a parallel between extremism and secularization.
Between what?
Extremism and secularization.
Extremism?
Yes.
Political extremism?
Religious extremism. Fundamentalism.
Yeah, okay. Fundamentalism and what?
Secularization.
Yes, okay. So, yes. So, to your grace, that was a very interesting question. Thank you. So, I think you are absolutely right that the seeking never ends. But in fundamentalism, the seeking ends. That's the process, that's the problem. They stop seeking and they believe that they have found the answer, and the form which that answer takes, they believe, is written in stone. And that is the dynamic that leads to a ossification of the religious spirit and to the distortions, where it becomes the secular form. The secular form is just that, and then it loses its connection to the sacred experience. And when it does so, it is it can actually do harm.
Cred că pot să traduc răspunsul acum. Întrebarea e foarte pertinentă și aveți dreptate. Această căutare a lui Dumnezeu nu se sfârșește niciodată. Tocmai acesta este eroarea fundamentalismului, pentru care căutarea a luat sfârșit. Aici este problema. Ei consideră că au găsit deja răspunsul, că au încetat căutarea și răspunsul pe care l-au găsit este... Cel definitiv. Acest lucru duce la o osificare a sferei religioase și tocmai de aceea secularismul înseamnă o pierdere a legăturii cu experiența sacrului, ceea ce este în cele din urmă periculos și dăunător.
Constanța, ne-am cunoscut ultima oară acum 2 ani aici la Constanța, de asemenea, și îmi face o deosebită bucurie să vă revăd. Legat de aprecierile dumneavoastră vis-a-vis de secularizare, problemă care m-a preocupat de lungul timpului, și mai ales legat de afirmația pe care ați făcut-o, dacă am înțeles eu bine, cum că acest fenomen al secularizării se va sfârși până la urmă, religia nu va dispare, este o afirmație care este în atenția foarte multor analiști, sociologi, filozofi, teologi, istorici și așa mai departe. Cazul Statelor Unite ale Americii, ținând seama de faptul că este alături de Japonia un caz cu totul aparte, în sensul că în Statele Unite practicanții religioși sunt în număr, totuși, în pofida modernității și supra-tehnologizării țării, foarte numeroși, dacă am înțeles eu bine, în urma analizelor sociologice, undeva la 40% din populația Statelor Unite, alături de Japonia. Deci cazul acesta este un caz care infirmă teza potrivit căreia modernitatea va conduce la o secularizare și pentru faptul că este incompatibilă cu religia. Cele două cazuri, Statele Unite și Japonia, sunt date și astăzi de către sociologi ca două exemple care infirmă această teză, și anume că tehnologia, știința vor elimina religia din orizontul lumii. Pe de altă parte, există astăzi, așa cum știm, țări puternic secularizate, mai ales în Europa Occidentală, țări care alimentează încă foarte multe speculații în această privință. Problema este că, în cele din urmă, ne punem întrebarea dacă această secularizare pe linia postmodernismului, care operează tot felul de mutații în conștiința și în comportamentul religios al omului, dacă nu cumva acest postmodernism nu va elimina religia, dar o va modifica fundamental ca fenomen și ca și comportament. Mă gândesc la faptul că, de pildă, sociologul german Georg Schmidtchen afirmă că religia nu va dispare, dar își va modifica totalmente în perspectivă, pe termen lung, formele de expresie sau de manifestare. Prin urmare, există riscul, spun anumiți analiști, ca religia să iese din acest proces de secularizare foarte sărăcită. Adică există riscul, de pildă, al dezinstituționalizării și privatizării religiei. Adică să devină un fenomen, o credință strict personală, care nu mai are nimic de a face cu instituția bisericii. Credeți în această variantă, cum că religia în urma secularizării va ieși foarte sărăcită, sau credeți ceea ce afirmă alți sociologi și analiști, cum ar fi José Casanova, care a fost pomenit aici, alături de alții care vorbesc despre o religie post-seculară, sau mai precis despre o desecularizare a societății postmoderne mai devreme sau mai târziu? Aștept o apreciere din partea dumneavoastră, vă mulțumesc foarte mult.
Professor, my greetings from Constanța. We met here 2 years ago and I'm very pleased to see you again. Father Achim, excuse me. Yes. I was very interested in your remarks concerning this process of secularization. So you made this statement that this phenomenon finally cannot bring about a disappearance of religion. There are many sociologists, philosophers, theologians, historians who are very concerned with this issue. We have a special case of the United States and Japan, in which we have many practitioners, many religious people, despite all the technological development. We know that an estimate shows that 40% of the population in the United States are religious people, and so is the case of Japan. So these two cases infirm the idea, contradict the idea that modernity should result in a secularization because modernity is incompatible with religion. On the other hand, there are other countries which are very highly secular, for instance, in Western Europe, and they fuel all these speculations about technology eliminating religion and modernity eliminating religion. So finally, there is this question whether this secularization process, along with all the postmodern mutations in the religious behavior, religious conscience, are they going not to eliminate religion but modify it as a phenomenon and as religious behavior is concerned? So there is this risk that the religion would be very much impoverished because of this process of secularization. There is this risk that it will be deinstitutionalized. It will become a strictly personal affair or nothing to do with the institution of the church. My question is, do you believe that this is the case, or rather you believe in what other scholars assert, for instance, José Casanova, who says that there will be a phenomenon of what he terms a post-secular religion. The secularization sooner or later will result in what he terms a post-secular religion. So your opinion on that?
Yes, thank you for those very interesting remarks, Professor, and it's nice to see you again. I agree with what you said, and my sense is that, as Tocqueville reminded us, and he probably wasn't the first to say it, but I will say it, only a god can kill a god. And so attempts at creating a totally secular societies are fatuous. They never succeed. So, if the religion of today is to be replaced, I think all of that is, the language in which we discuss secularization gives too much credit to the secular critics, to the postmodern or the modern critics of religion. It gives too much credit to the Hobbesians. That was part of what I was saying. I think they're just wrong. And religion always changes. Religion always has a dynamic relationship with the society which it's part of. And so, are we really in a unique moment? I don't think we are. I really don't think, in one sense, we are in a unique moment. So, religion will continue to be a vital part of society, but it will continue to change. And certainly this movement toward personal religion, religious bricolage, and non-institutional expression has been a big part of our life and probably will continue to be. But it will never complete. I mean, religion is social by its very nature. So it cannot simply be the whole picture. Religion will always bring people together. People who had a similar experience of the luminous and want to find others to talk to it, to about it. So the social dimension of religion is not going to be replaced by post-modernity.
Thank you. În traducere, putem, sunt de acord cu dumneavoastră și putem să ne amintim de cuvintele lui Tocqueville, care zice că numai un Dumnezeu poate înlocui un alt Dumnezeu. Cu alte cuvinte, este imposibil, sunt sortite eșecului aceste încercări de a se crea o societate care să fie complet seculară. Ați pus o întrebare, ce se întâmplă în momentul acesta. Cred că acordăm prea mult credit criticilor moderni și postmoderni ai religiei. Ei se înșală. Este adevărat că religia este în schimbare continuă pentru că ea se află într-o relație dinamică cu societatea și nu cred nici măcar că în momentul acesta este unic. Religia va continua să joace un rol vital chiar dacă ea este mereu în schimbare. La întrebarea noastră, dacă va fi redusă la o credință strict personală și dezinstituționalizată, eu cred că religia întotdeauna va face parte din viața omului și ea, prin natura ei, are un caracter social. Ea aduce la o altă oamenii care au avut această experiență a luminosului. Deci, dimensiunea socială este proprie religie și ea nu poate să fie înlocuită, abolită de paradigma postmodernă.
There are any questions? Okay, thank you, dear professor.
My dear pleasure to be with you all. Archbishop, again, my greetings. I wish I could be with you, but my broken leg is not going to allow that.
Yeah.
So, thank you again for this opportunity to be with you.
Okay, thank you, dear professor. See you soon. Thank you.
Vreau să felicităm pentru claritatea care ne-a obișnuit și continuă să o exprime. Cred că fiecare a înțeles în modul cel mai precis ce a vrut să spună și este foarte realist. Îi mulțumim!
His Grace thanks you. I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, Professor? So His Grace thanks and he appreciates the clarity of your explanations. Everyone here has understood very clearly your remarks, and thank you.